Welcome to my Soul Series. Soul Series is part of Oprah and Friends, exclusively on XM Radio Channel 156. And you can listen to the entire Soul Series collection on xmradio.com/Oprah. Well, I interviewed Wayne Dyer so many years ago when I was doing a show in Baltimore called People Are Talking. And then in 1996 on the Oprah Winfrey Show, and then in 1999 on the Oprah Winfrey Show. Over the years, he's become known as the father of motivation. So inviting him to be a part of our Soul Series, the father of motivation, well, that's a no-brainer. It's uplifting, enlightening, truly powerful. Welcome to Soul Series. Hi, everybody. I'm Oprah, and I'm really hoping that you're getting as much from this series as I am. And I'm so happy to have here today someone who has studied in the ancient Chinese religion of Taoism. And before I introduce him, for better historic understanding and context, a little Taoism 101. Approximately 200 million people adhere to traditional Chinese religions, of which Taoism is considered predominant. It takes its name from the word Tao, translated literally as the way. It looks like Tao, but it's really Tao. Mm-hmm. And it's based on the Tao Te Ching, which was written over 2,500 years ago. And legend has it that, is it Lao Tzu?
Lao Tzu.
Lao Tzu is the founder and the author of the Tao Te Ching. And it's comprised of 81 passages, 81. And according to my guest, it describes a way of living that's balanced, moral, and spiritual, and that works for all facets of life on earth. So we're going to be talking about the Tao Te Ching today. But first, I don't even know how to begin to introduce you, because we were going through all the books that you have. I just say umpteen.
31.
Okay. Umpteen bestsellers.
Right.
Including The Power of Intention, which actually is my all-time favorite. Do you know who it is, listeners? It's Dr. Wayne Dyer. And he is here to talk about the Tao, which is his latest book, Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life, Living the Wisdom of the Tao. So, why the Tao? Why now? Why now the Tao?
Well, the Tao is one of those things that kept coming at me. It's I call it a calling, when you just keep getting sort of like synchronistic callings from, you know, somebody would tell me about it, and then I had talked to someone who had been through a very difficult time with addictions and so on, and wasn't able to do anything in the program, but was just read the Tao every single day. And the only thing that seemed to work for this particular person and others, including one of my own children who has struggled with addictions herself, was in reading the Tao.
That's interesting, because, you know, that whole controversy I had with James Frye,
right.
I don't know if you know about it.
I do.
But one of the he says that was one of the things that also helped him, that struggling with addiction.
That was the person. James called my daughter, as a matter of fact.
Really?
And was willing to do anything at all to help her. I mean, he's, you know, someone that I have a great deal of love and respect for. And what he said to me was that I wouldn't do the program, I wouldn't do the 10 steps, I didn't want to substitute one kind of an addiction for another,
right.
But I would read the Tao.
Uh-huh.
And then my publisher out in California called me and said, you've got to read this book, and you've got to do this. And every time I would turn on the television or something, I would be some kind of reference to the Tao. And I've gotten to the point in my life and in my career where I listened when these sort of things that start coming at you from a distance and
that
you're not quite sure.
That appear to be coincidences.
They appear to be, but there's no such thing.
Yeah,
there's no coincidence. In fact, you know, the word coincidence itself is a mathematical term. You remember in geometry they would say two angles that coincide are said to be two angles that fit together perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
So now we've taken a term that means two things that fit together perfectly and interpreted it to mean something that fits together accidentally, which we've just reversed the whole concept of coincidence. It's
wow.
Coincide. So I called my publisher and I said,
I just had an aha moment. I never heard it explained that way before.
Really?
Thank you. Yeah. That was great.
So it's
So the Tao kept calling you.
Yeah, it just kept calling me and calling at me, and I would read a little bit of it, and I taught at a university. I even taught a little bit about world religions, and mm-hmm. I taught about Taoism and so on, but I really wasn't really that familiar with it. And then I began to do the research on it, and most of the people who write about the Tao say it's the wisest book ever written. It's the most translated book in the history of publishing, other than the Bible.
Other than the Bible,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and there are 14,000 different interpretations or translations that I came across myself. And so I would read the very first verse, the opening line of the Tao. Says, the Tao that can be named is not the Tao. You can call things something, and the minute that you call something or put a label on it, then it's no longer the Tao.
Yes, you know, I was wondering, I was saying this to the producer of our show, that I obviously wanted to talk to you about it, but I was thinking, do you need to be further evolved along the spiritual path before you can begin to accept or receive the concepts of the Tao?
Not at all.
You don't?
Not at all. Some of the most common things that you say every day in your life came right out of the Tao Te Ching.
Yeah, but I know the whole idea of no rules.
Right. The journey of 1,000 miles
begins with one step.
Mm-hmm. Those who know don't speak. Those who speak don't know. Think small rather than thinking big. All of these kinds of comments and things have come out of this little Chinese man. I mean, Lao Tzu translates to old man. This old man that just had these visions about how to go about living our lives conflict-free, mm-hmm. how to live without having any enemies, how to be at peace. You know what it really taught me, Oprah? Because I did it for a whole year. It taught me to think like God thinks. And that was that's my favorite quote from Einstein. You know, his whole idea, he said, I don't want to be consumed with the details. I'm just paraphrasing. He said, I just want to learn to think like God thinks,
yes.
And so how does God think? And I began to see that God thinks without force, you know, makes everything happen without any force at all. There are no one is excluded. Everyone is included. God does nothing but give. Mm-hmm. It's always about giving. You know, Hafiz, the great poet from the 13th century, said that he was talking about, you know, just about giving. He said, even after all this time, the sun never says to the earth, you owe me. He said, just think what a love like that does. It lights up the whole sky.
Wow.
It lights up the whole sky. And it's just, so it's like if you can, you know, there's been so much talk about The Secret, you know.
Right,
I know,
yes.
You've done shows on it, and, you know, I was asked to be a part of
that. I wanted to talk to you about that. First of all, I wanted to ask you, do you feel somewhat validated?
I just feel so grateful and so thrilled that more. It's one of the most popular nonfiction books in the history of publishing. Over 10 million copies are out there. I mean, it's giving people a look at the power of what happens when you change the way you look at things. The things you look at change. I mean, the world begins to change when you change the way you look at it. I would have liked to have seen a little different emphasis myself. I think too much of it is on getting rather than giving. And,
mm-hmm.
And if you have this incredible power to align yourself with a universal divine mind that is always giving and always offering, then it seems to me that's where we ought to be putting our attention.
Yeah, actually, I was surprised when I first saw, you know, the first tape of The Secret. I was actually surprised that you weren't on there.
I was asked to be.
Okay, that makes sense, because I thought, well, you are the father of all this.
Yeah.
So, why did you choose not to be?
I didn't want to be a part of that emphasis any longer. And that was really my...
reason for doing Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life.
And it was really the result of my living... the way I'm living now. The way I'm living now is on an island. It's in a place where I can just get as much validation from a tree or a spider or, you know, anything in nature. I mean, what Lao Tzu taught me is that God is in nature. And you have to find your own nature, and that in every single one of us, in every human being out there listening, we have a nature, and we know what that nature is, and we know what our calling is. We just haven't changed our thoughts to be in alignment with it. And this, what I want to do with this, and this is, to me...
this being Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life.
Yeah, this is about teaching people how, what they should be thinking. Become more flexible.
Right.
Become less rule-oriented. Become more open. Don't have any enemies. This is Lao Tzu was teaching all of us 2,500 years ago. This is the way to think and to have a moral word.
Yeah. Don't talk about peace. Be peace.
Right.
Don't look to be virtuous. Be virtuous.
Be humble.
Yes.
Be peaceful. Be loving. Be all of these kinds of things. Be serene. Be content. You know, stop trying so hard. Just sit, get back, relax, enjoy. The next thing I'm going to do is on the dynamics of how to change a thought. Because most people know that what they should be thinking.
Yes.
They just don't really know.